welcome to the stage, Pat Kiernan and Jamie Stelter.
Hey, we have a theme song.
We do.
Music director Leslie Goshko, ladies and gentlemen.
Oh, hello.
Thank you, Leslie.
We found Leslie on Twitter.
Story of my life.
We did. I met my husband on Twitter, too.
That's true. Hey, I have some blue. You have some orange.
I do. We wanted, it must be a room full of Yankees fans. We are in our orange and blue, though.
Well, how would we know when we picked this date that it would be the first World Series game?
I don't even think any of the most loyal Mets fans would have ever guessed that the Mets were going to go to the World Series.
Some of them would have. Roger Clark would have guessed that.
And I did wear sneakers tonight. I know everyone's probably like, did she forget to change her shoes?
What you don't see on TV is that Jamie always has some sort of inappropriate footwear on.
I do. I actually have a hard time walking in heels, but I like to play it off like it's some fun fashion statement. But I just was dressed as if I was going to be on TV. I kind of forgot people were going to see all of me. So I hope you like it.
I do. Now we'll try to do Mets score updates or something.
Yeah.
Yeah, we'll keep an eye on that.
Sure.
If it does, maybe you are all Yankees fans. All right. Marathon this weekend as well. Anybody running? Not anybody know
Ooh.
Anybody who's running? It's that kind of crowd.
And you live right on the marathon.
Literally, I am on Bedford Avenue. And so we feel like...
Brooklyn!
We feel like when you live on the marathon route, you are required to have all of your friends over on marathon day.
Right.
It's like if you live on Central Park West and the Macy's Thanksgiving Day Parade is going by, you have to invite everybody to come look out your window.
And your party is, I mean, you live up to the hype. You do throw a fun party.
We just serve some food and tell people you can stand on the sidewalk
yeah.
in front
I mean,
of our
I
house.
I mean, I go for the food, but yeah. But lots of street closures for the marathon. If anyone's staying here for the weekend.
Ladies and gentlemen, it's the Rail and Road Report now.
It is. Is it 08 or 38 past the hour? I can't even know.
What time will the street closures be lifted?
Some of them Sunday as the marathon ends, and some of them not till Monday after they clean it all up.
That was a really good answer.
I know.
She's always on the clock, ladies and gentlemen. So in anticipation of this, mm-hmm. one of the things we did was had lunch with Cindy Adams last Friday.
Right.
I think every New Yorker should at some point have a chance to have lunch with Cindy Adams.
She, yes, give it up for Cindy Adams, if you know who she is.
She wrote her column about it in the Post yesterday.
She did. She is a treat. She said, and just we were just talking about where you live, she says that you live in, quote, foreign territory called Williamsburg. Cindy doesn't leave the Upper East Side much, or Midtown East.
No, I think it's a very confined area.
Yeah.
We came to her.
Yeah. And she has very specific opinions about, she was really caught off guard that I'm from Philadelphia, and that you're from Canada, and that somehow we're doing this New York show.
And if she doesn't like your answer, she just moves on to the next question halfway through the answer.
Yes, yes. She's not sitting around and waiting for you to please her in any way.
But it was fun.
It was fun.
And then the column turned out well. Jamie actually admitted in the column that, how many times have you slept in for work?
Once only.
I think that you've jinxed yourself.
I know, I'm a little bit nervous about that. But we do wake up really early, and we should point out, I think we look and seem rather well-rested for it being prime time right now.
When I arrived at the Cindy Adams lunch, I went to check my bag. I literally walked away from Jamie for a minute, and when I come back, she and Cindy are in this deep hair and makeup conversation.
Well, she had very specific opinions about how I should wear my hair, and I was telling her if she wanted to come to the station at 4 a.m. and do that for me, I would welcome that.
You don't drink coffee.
I do not.
I don't drink coffee. You see the you know what I feel like I'm missing this time of year? Is the do you drink coffee, Lisa?
Gallons.
Okay.
Are you kidding?
Do you drink the pumpkin spice latte?
I drink anything that will fit in a mug. Irish or otherwise, okay. I will drink.
Irish or otherwise.
I feel like the pumpkin thing has gotten beyond ridiculous this year.
It is.
All of the pumpkin byproducts.
Well, there's pumpkin donuts, there's pumpkin munchkins, there's pumpkin everything. There's like pumpkin hairspray, pumpkin eyeshadow, pumpkin.
You know, there's the rule that you can't wear white after Labor Day. Is there a drop dead date on pumpkin spice? Is it the day after Thanksgiving? Do you get to go to New Year's?
I hope that it would end after Thanksgiving. I mean, what do you need after that? Do they have a new Christmas flavor after that?
Well, no, there's nothing that steps in for pumpkin, but I think it's a seasonal.
It's too much for me.
Any pumpkin spice latte fans?
I know.
Two of them.
I know a couple of you, so aren't telling the truth out there. So you were away earlier this week.
We were in Miami. It was Lucy, my eldest daughter's 14th birthday,
and
she had wanted to go to the Taylor Swift concert, and we noticed that the Taylor Swift concert was in Miami on the 27th on her birthday.
Right.
So we flew down there.
Somehow you forgot to tell me that. Oh, we're gonna go to Taylor Swift.
Tickets were expensive enough. I'm not bringing you. You buy your own tickets. But you know how much it rained on Wednesday when we were flying back. So it was one of those things where you sit at the airport in Miami and we're delayed by half an hour because of a ground hold at LaGuardia, very slow traffic at LaGuardia today, and then another half hour, and then we got on the plane and it was half an hour holding before we took off. And then actually we got as far as Washington and we had to do two giant circles over Chesapeake Bay.
Ugh.
And then it was one of those landings in the clouds where you're kind of bumping your way down to the ground. And then we landed and it was one of those flights where everybody was so nervous about the landing by this that we got the big round of applause for the pilot.
I like the round of applause.
Yeah, it was fun. And I was thinking, should you have rounds of applause in every profession?
Well, a lot of people think that we sit next to each other every day.
No,
but I'm up a flight of stairs.
Oh, do you secretly applaud me from upstairs?
Yeah, after the papers every day. I'm like,
bravo, Pat.
Excellent journal.
Yeah, no, the whole team downstairs applauds at every traffic report, and you'd think it would get tired.
See?
Yeah.
So we don't even have to go into the airline industry.
No, but it would just be nice if everybody for a day got applause on all of their triumphs in their day at their job.
How optimistic of you. You're usually not that, like, cheerful.
All right. did you see the report this morning that congestion pricing is coming back?
Yeah, how do you feel about that?
I live near the Williamsburg Bridge. And I
think let's prime people a little bit.
Okay. Congestion pricing, this is what you want me to chip in,
yeah,
and prime people? Congestion pricing, the plan that Mayor Bloomberg proposed where they would charge you for driving in Manhattan at key hours. So if you wanted to drive below 60th Street, they would charge you. If you wanted to come over any of the bridges, even the ones that are free now, they would charge
right.
you a toll. The idea is, it's been done in London, the idea is that it would reduce traffic in Midtown and we could all get around a little easier, but it's expensive. So that now the progressive caucus of the city council is saying, yeah, we like that.
Right.
And so it's got a little momentum again under Mayor.
Well, because right now everyone goes for the bridges that are free.
No, this is the crazy thing. From Williamsburg, I'm kind of halfway to the Williamsburg Bridge, halfway to the Manhattan, to the Midtown Tunnel. The Midtown Tunnel is the one that's set up to take all the traffic volume. You can go in this way and this way and this way.
Right.
The Midtown Tunnel is a very efficient crossing. Nobody uses it because it's 10
Expensive.
Bucks.
Expensive.
Yeah, whatever it is, yeah.
I think congestion pricing is a good idea.
Well, okay.
Yeah, spread out the love. Doesn't that make more sense?
No, well, if it's a room full of Manhattan subway and taxi riders, they're fine with it. As soon as you get a room with the Brooklyn and Queens residents who are driving to the city, like, don't take away my free Brooklyn Bridge.
Right. Or tourists. It is coming up on tourist season.
Yeah, it is. Don't get me started on that, because I got the whole gridlock alert day rant. I would be fine if we never had another tourist here.
Hold on one second. Mom, Dad, earmuffs for a second. Earmuffs. Go ahead.
No, especially at, you know, we work in Chelsea Market up on the 6th floor.
Yeah.
And Chelsea Market, in the time that New York One has been there, has apparently found its way onto every tourist guide in the world. And they all get there, and they're walking as slow as possible. And they're looking for the free samples of the food. And the, what?
I'm gonna show you what happened to me the other day in Chelsea Market.
Is this gonna be violent?
No. So the other day, Chelsea Market, if you haven't been there, it's lined on both sides with restaurants and shops, and it's not that wide. And it is lined, and it is packed with tourists at all time of day. And of course, I'm done at noon, and that is prime tourist lunchtime. So it's one thing the rest of the year, but the other day, I'm walking in Chelsea.
Is this, by the way, did you own this selfie stick prior to this gag?
My friend Leslie, who is here, Leslie, there you are. My friend Leslie gave this to me, and anyone can give side eye to a selfie stick. I love a selfie stick. It takes good pictures, but it should be used the way that I used it when I first got it, in a pool, on a family vacation, where there's no one that you're bothering.
Okay.
So I'm walking through.
Am I required to stand to assist in the demonstration?
No, so I'm walking through Chelsea Market, and there is a group as large as this audience standing in the middle of Chelsea Market, and there's one guy like, hold on, hold on, it's selfie time. And I'm like, I just need to get to the front door. And there is a guy who's has 20 people behind him deep with the selfie stick in his hand.
Oh,
and then
he's
like,
holding you back?
Oh yeah, he's like, nobody gets through until my selfie's done.
Yeah, because when you go to work at 4 a.m., when somebody says you're allowed to leave,
You
really just want to get straight to the door.
Yes, straight to the door. I hate to be cranky about it, but come on with the selfie stick in those situations.
Yeah. Or if you take a meeting near Times Square, that's the worst thing.
No. Cindy Adams was the only person I'd go to Midtown for.
We took to the streets of New York, and we asked New Yorkers, are tourists friend or foe?
What's going on, Pat and Jamie? We're here in some of the city's most popular areas to talk to New Yorkers and tourists alike about what they think about the Big Apple. Let's see who we can find. Do you like tourists?
Depends.
Yes and no.
You know, they're mostly annoying, but they add a lot of value. You know, they mostly just get in your way.
If I am on the go and I'm rushing to get somewhere, then it's annoying.
Some are like, they just won't move and like, I need to get somewhere.
Fortunately, we live on West 15th, so the tourists don't always come that far down.
Subway, it's always on the subway when you're like trying to get on and you gotta get that 4 train and there's like people with a map in front of their faces and they're like not getting the turnstile and like, that's usually when I'm like...
You're like, don't you have Google Maps? What are you doing with that map?
Yeah, I'm like, guys, like, I gotta go.
Well, as long as I stay away from Times Square, I can kind of avoid most of them.
I'm trying to get somewhere and there's always a tourist walking like a robot in my way.
They're always looking around at the map and everything, so they're holding things up, you know, so maybe I'm turning into a New Yorker because I think, hurry up now, you know, move out the way.
But then they take up the entire, like, sidewalk, and you're like, can you guys just move aside a little bit, you know, maybe get on a tour?
That seems to be the core complaint, actually, they're just in the way.
Right, like in Chelsea Market, it's like, just move.
If they would step aside, people, we got a city to operate here.
Yeah, we're trying to get somewhere.
No, because they're used to going to places like Disneyland, where nothing's happening but the tourist activity. Right? Anybody who's at Disneyland is there to be a tourist, or they're working.
It is true. Well, so then we started to explore this theme.
Mm-hmm.
How many of the visitors to New York actually like New York?
Yeah. So let's continue with the next video. These are the opinions of the tourists, because we're so mean to them, we don't want them here. So we found some tourists and said, hey, are you enjoying the city?
Is this your first time to New York?
It is my first time, and I am so excited. Oh my God, I'm like, hello, New Yorkers.
What are your impressions about New York?
It's a great city. I love it here. Yep, it's a city of dreams.
It's just so busy. And everyone's really friendly.
That's good, because New Yorkers don't always get the best rap.
No, you can't talk on the trains here, though. People look at you when you talk on the trains.
What have you heard about New Yorkers before you have come here?
We heard that everything like moved fast, yeah. And they were sort of like no time for us. There's some really friendly New Yorkers we've met.
Yeah, I thought they'd be really unfriendly, but everyone's so nice. The homeless people are really nice.
Have you had any interactions with New Yorkers during your stay?
Yeah, policemen.
What have you guys been up to?
No, just asking for directions, yeah.
That's nice. Were they helpful?
Yeah, very helpful, yeah.
What have you heard about New Yorkers?
Okay, well, New Yorkers all wear black. They're not friendly, apparently. They're not like the Southern charm. But there's a lot of movement and a lot of activity, and they're well-dressed. These people are well-dressed.
The constant words is, oh, sorry, none of it. You're kind of just pushed out the way if you're not walking fast enough. That's kind of how it goes.
Yeah. Interesting. Well, on behalf of all New Yorkers, I apologize for everyone that's bumped into you.
The tourists are so nice that we found. Yeah.
Now I feel kind of bad.
No, I don't feel bad at all. Oh. Actually, they were in Times Square, which is a tourist area.
Mm-hmm.
The New Yorkers don't go there.
That's true.
So, just because in Times Square we couldn't find nasty tourists, we wondered, where could you go to find cranky tourists?
Wherever you go to find cranky everything.
Yeah.
The internet.
So we went looking for Yelp reviews and tweets from people who may not have had such a good experience in New York City. Shall we?
Let's steer it.
Here is tourist review number one.
Tourists can be cranky, tourists can be sweet, but the truth comes out in Yelp reviews and their tweets.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, tourist review number one.
Rolling around New York City is like skating at a crowded general public skating session.
It's, especially on the rink at Rockefeller Center is so tiny.
You can't.
The rest of the city feels like that.
No.
Okay. Tourist review number two.
This place is truly one of the main reasons to come to New York. Awesome food, staff, atmosphere. Hey, if you're a fan of good food, you get your ass down to Bubba Gump's in Times Square.
Five-star review.
We all want different things from the city. Bubba Gump's prime attraction.
Uh-huh.
If you do one thing in New York City.
That's where you gotta go.
Bubba Gump's.
Number three.
I've never been to New York City before because it's nothing but overpriced crap. The whole city's full of ignorance and the people that live there think it's so great. Wife wanted to see some shows, so we went.
Wife wanted to see some show.
Only there because of the wife. I don't even remember what the show was, some dancing.
How about number four?
New York is not worth it. Nothing attractive at all and not much to see. Better off just going to Pittsburgh.
6-1, half a dozen the
Pittsburgh.
Other.
Pittsburgh.
Well, you're from Pennsylvania.
Oh, Pittsburgh, come on. Philadelphia, okay. Pittsburgh.
All right, tourist review number five.
Eyesore. We expected something spectacular. Instead, all we saw were ugly buildings.
And like the top of his review is ugly, not what we expected. Like, have you not seen photos of New York?
You actually don't like a lot of the tall buildings.
No, oh, I don't like that finger building that's on the Park Avenue there that has ruined the skyline. No, I don't like that at all.
No, that's not a nice. They're like going up everywhere.
You see that building as you come across the Kosciuszko Bridge coming into
to
Williamsburg.
Bridge?
Kosciuszko.
Kosciuszko.
Kosciuszko. It's okay. Where are the? Do we have any Polish people in the audience? Is it Kosciuszko or Kosciuszko, whatever you just said?
No, I'm telling you what it is.
Okay.
I'm the traffic reporter.
I know, but it's. I live among the Poles in Williamsburg and Greenpoint.
Check in with your neighbors.
All right, I will. I will. Donna next door is Polish, and I'm going to review the pronunciation with her. Where are we? Number six? Here's tourist review number six.
Too much pumpkin color after Halloween. And Times Square sucks, but it's still kind of cool.
Ladies and gentlemen, you recognize the voice reading our tweets and tourist reviews. It is Alan Kalter.
Alan, thank you. Good to see you.
Hi. Good to see you.
Hey, my wife had a great idea just to solve a problem because I was watching from backstage. She and I always worked in New York City, and she's always said, make it two lanes of walking, Brooklyn and New York. The tourists go here, and they can go as slow as they want, and the residents...
Like paint a line down the middle of the sidewalk?
The pace of New York continues.
Somebody did that for a gag video, and some people thought that it was real. They were like, oh, what a great idea.
It is a great idea.
It is a great idea.
Yeah.
Your wife should run for political office here.
Yeah, she could. She could.
Alan Kalter, of course, famed for 20 years with David Letterman.
Thank you very much. Been a great time. Thank you.
So, Alan, there was, about a month ago, there was a picture of Letterman with the Santa Claus beard.
Yeah, that's the real Letterman.
Well, you weren't tempted to mix it up after you retired from the Letterman show?
I'll tell you something. If he had his choice, he would have come in just like that every single day, with his hat on, the baseball cap on, and the T-shirt, and chinos, and just that's Letterman. As a matter of fact, it was about 5 years I used to dress in jeans and come in any way I wanted to. And then he saw Paul Schaefer just before he went to the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame with his band. That night they were gonna get on a plane and they were all dressed up and they were in ties for the first time. And Dave said, that looks pretty good. Why don't you dress like that every single night? And then he looked at me and he went, you too.
You too. Oh man.
But it was a great run.
You have lived in Stamford for many years.
Since 76, yeah.
But you had an apartment near the studio.
I was a half a block from the studio for 20-something years.
Did your employer abuse that?
No, he didn't. It was great, though, because I would show... The show was taped at 4:30 in the afternoon until 5:30. I had to be there at 4 o'clock for makeup and then to get into my dress. And then after I was completely dressed up and ready to go on stage, they would do the show, and I would do the ending of the show, and then 10 minutes later, I'd be released. So it was, for me, a very, very difficult hour and 30 minutes.
And does that include your 30-second commute time?
Yeah, yeah, into
I mean,
it.
I only live 10 or so blocks from work, and I always sort of brag about the fact that I don't have a commute. I mean, the time of day helps also, but a half a block is...
It was really
that's an
easy.
Award-winning commute.
And 4 days a week, and during the months of the summer, 3 days a week, and when there was a sporting event on that week, 2 days a week. And we got off 12 weeks a year in addition to that. So you guys thought you were watching new shows every night, but they were all reruns.
Well, yeah.
It was a nice job.
I guess you realize as that job is going on that's the job that comes along once in a lifetime.
Once in a lifetime. One of the intros when I was first on the show was, from New York, where this guy is working less than any guy in New York City. And then after 9/11, of course, and he was phenomenal at 9/11, we changed the intro every night to, from New York, the greatest city in the world. And it was, and it always will be, the greatest city in the world. It's just a phenomenal city we've got. It really is.
I said that the other day after, when it was the 3-year anniversary of Hurricane Sandy, and I said the one thing I really remember was how everybody came together then.
Yeah.
Yeah, and there was so much that happened in those days after that we couldn't keep track of all of the news stories that were moving around.
Well, wasn't it true what he said, Dave said in his first night back, if we stop doing comedy, if we stop doing shows that really entertain, then they win. Don't let them win. Hmm.
So you did a recurring segment, which was the Alan Kalter celebrity interview.
Yeah.
For those who weren't familiar with it, let's just say there was some salty and blunt language.
Yes.
You got straight to the point with the celebrities and didn't tolerate much nonsense from them. How much of that is actually you?
All of it. No, very little of it. The whole idea of that was Dave would be interviewing someone who is a big star, and then after that, the producer would go over and say, would you mind going over to Alan's seat, letting him do a thing with you over there? It'll be like an interview, but we're not going to tell you what it is, and he's really not going to talk to you, he's going to talk to Dave. And so my open to every one of those segments when Dave said, and now Alan Kalter's celebrity interview, was to look at Dave and get real PO to Dave for taking all of the glory away from my guest. And then I'd end it by saying, and you, your mother. And then the guests would be surprised because they didn't know what was coming. And then I would talk about their latest movie or their hairdo. Or with Paris Hilton, I remember sidling up to her at the very end and saying, and now let's talk about you. Those shoes don't go with that hair. And and I left the stage. And Dave would always say something like, we apologize to our guest for what Alan said. And Paris, who was told not to say anything, looked at Dave and she went, he knows nothing about fashion. But they were a joy. They were a joy.
You went to law school.
I did.
For a time. You taught high school.
I did.
And then there was a fork in the road?
I would still be teaching today if the teachers got the last word and not the parents. But times have changed, and times changed then, and I was always doing radio on weekends, so I went straight into radio, quit teaching, loved it, but still quit it, went right into radio in New York City. Brooklyn. WHN Radio, 1986.
And you were Brooklyn born.
1973.
Born in Brooklyn.
Born in Brooklyn, and still consider myself a Brooklyn Dodger fan. How many of you are Brooklyn Dodger fans? How many of you are old enough to be Brooklyn Dodger fans? Yeah.
All right, we got one.
Have you picked a team in this World Series?
Well, I like the Mets, and I'm going with the Mets.
Oh, you're not that much of a Brooklyn Dodger fan, that you?
I'm a New York fan. I've developed into a New York fan. Any New York team over the years. I'm a big New York Giant fan.
Oh.
But I love the Jets. Want the Mets to go all the way.
I do think the Mets is a fun storyline to get behind.
Yeah.
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 You don't have a Philadelphia conflict with the Mets storyline?
Not at the moment.
How do you feel about hip Williamsburg and hip Brooklyn and all that? Happened in Brooklyn?
You know, we talked once before about the different things in New York, and you said, how has New York changed? Brooklyn has changed. Brooklyn is unbelievable now. It's a mecca. It's museums, it's restaurants, it's places to walk that we didn't have when I was in Brooklyn. Of course, I moved out of Brooklyn when I was 6 months old, so I didn't really experience the whole borough. But it's a marvelous place, and Midtown's a marvelous place for people watching, for everything else, restaurants, theaters, just, it's great. But the one thing New York has and Brooklyn has that they don't have through the rest of the country, bagels.
Hmm.
You can't get a New York bagel anywhere but in New York. I don't know what it is, but it tastes better here. It really does.
Oh, give it up for bagels.
That's very true. And on the things that have changed in New York have been great. But the thing that really hit me about New York, because I remember you talking about what you like and don't like about New York, was what I didn't like about New York. And I experienced it 2 weeks ago. I was in Hawaii.
Mm-hmm.
And I got up at 7 in the morning on Sunday and began watching football.
That's nice.
It was over by lunchtime.
That's so nice. I have a series. I'm a big Eagles fan.
Yeah.
Yes. And I feel like I know who's cheering out there. And I have a really big problem with all the primetime NFL games because we have to wake up so early.
It ruins it. Yeah.
I have to go to bed before they even start.
Moved to Hawaii. You could do this from Hawaii. You could do your helicoptering from Hawaii and make it up.
I was going to say,
is traffic a problem?
Pat, it looks good down here.
You really could be anywhere. Now, since you've given up the apartment in the city, now the Letterman show's over, when you come back, is there one place that you have to have a meal?
Yeah.
Other than Bubba Gump Shrimp Company?
Yeah. Yeah. Three of them. I wouldn't have done this through May for those 20 years because I didn't want crowds there, but Cafe Cielo in Midtown,
mm-hmm.
Trattoria dell'Arte.
Of course.
I hope someone's writing this down.
56th Street and Gallagher's. Those were my three favorite places.
I don't think I've been to any of those.
I never told you about them before.
Only revealing your secret because you're not in the city full time.
Those were the greatest. And then as a fourth, maybe Subway.
Alan, great to have you here. Thank you.
Delight to be here.
Ladies and gentlemen, Alan Kalter.
Hey.
Thank you.
So as you can see, Pat and Jamie, there are some New Yorkers who aren't quite feeling the love for tourists. But to be fair, we spoke with a lot of people who really gave us hope that we can all live in harmony together in this beautiful city of ours. Do you like tourists?
Yeah, a lot.
I think they bring a sense of wonder. Like, I'll go to some place with, like, Times Square, where I've been like a million and one time. When I'm there with tourists who are going there for the first time, and I experience it with them, I say to myself, you know, hey, you know, this is something that is overwhelming. This is something that is special. This is something that is memorable.
Do you have nice interactions with tourists?
Well, basically, that's what helped make New York. Like, you know, this is the melting pot, and they should be welcomed. And, you know, they bring money.
The first time, like, I could actually tell someone, like, how to get to where they were going, I was like, yes, it's like something good. I felt really nice.
They're very excited about New York, and I think it's on everybody's list, you know. Everybody in the world needs to come to New York at least once, and here they are.
Top of the first inning. Barely in the top of the first inning. They are tied at zero. No score yet between Kansas City and the Mets.
Luckily, our next guest is not missing anything yet.
That's true. As soon as we heard what was going on, we were like, is our guest going to cancel? Yes, our next guest should probably be somewhere else right now. The entertaining sports columnist for the Wall Street Journal, Jason Gay, was somebody we thought of immediately when we were doing the show because we have a Twitter relationship with him.
Yeah, I wanted someone who always makes me laugh. And whether it's sports or more often, it's what he notices about life in New York that makes me laugh.
Yeah, and Jason writes sports that everybody can relate to. It's not a hardcore sports column, even though he knows his stuff. It's very relatable.
Right, so he has a column that he started. I don't know what was the first one, but it was, I think it might have been the touch football rules for during Thanksgiving.
Oh yeah, if you're playing family touch football during Thanksgiving.
Right, and they were hilarious. And then it became the rules that you need for your Super Bowl party. And the rules for all different things. And that then somehow became, I guess we'll ask him how it became into a book.
His new book comes out next week. It's called Little Victories, Perfect Rules for Imperfect Living. Although he may be just as famous for that tweet last week.
Yes.
This is 25 words. There they are. There's a guy in this coffee shop sitting at a table, not on his phone, not on a laptop, just drinking coffee like a psychopath.
I think I saw it not long after he tweeted it, and I was laughing, and it only had a couple of retweets, and then
it's been retweeted 33,000 times.
I mean,
millions of people have read that tweet and responded to it.
Yes.
I guess it struck a Starbucks chord with everybody.
So I guess Wall Street Journal, great, but I guess let's welcome Twitter star, Jason Gay. Thank you. What are we? Aww.
Jason, your book, it's a Halloween treat. Oh, and snacks.
I brought snacks.
Happy Halloween, Jason.
What?
Are you?
What? What? Halloween? Oh, Halloween! Yeah,
I got. Can you even hear us in there?
Sorry.
Can you hear us in there?
Yeah, I can hear you just fine.
Okay.
Thank you for the nice words about my tweet.
That was a really great tweet.
Wasn't it though?
Well, did you think about that tweet for a while?
Yeah.
I was the psychopath in the coffee shop, just sitting there.
That's like when everyone does the overheards, but it's really what was happening inside of their own brain.
Exactly. And, you know, you mention all the retweets, and, you know, because of Twitter's royalty policy, you get $1 for every retweet.
And that's how you afforded this costume.
So I bought this $33,000 shark costume on eBay.
Would you like to do a costume change, or are you wearing that for the duration?
You can't talk to a man in a shark costume,
no.
Pat? Pat, I've been watching you on TV for what feels like a generation. You can handle this. I think you're up to it.
I totally can. I just don't want you to be uncomfortable. I thought maybe the gag was out of the way.
What's not to be comfortable?
Is this the Katy Perry shark from the
show? I was going to ask that.
So it occurred to me, I just thought I was ordering, basic adult man shark costume. But it turns out to be this like pop culture signifier basically from 2014. So it's not even like a cool shark costume.
Yeah. It's like so last year.
I sense that Pat's not vibing on the shark look.
No, I like the shirt.
Okay.
The audience loves it.
Okay. All right. As long as they're happy.
So if you're a shark, what are your kids going to be for Halloween?
Well, I have a three-year-old who is vacillating between being a cow pig and a pig cow.
Oh.
What's the difference?
Yeah.
Oh, Pat. Basically, a cow pig is a cow body with a pig nose.
Oh,
okay. Got it.
And a pig cow is a pig body with a cow nose. He has both costumes. And so like Elton John, he could actually like switch halfway through Halloween.
Wait, did you, obviously you read the story about, and I'm gonna blank on his name, Harbaugh.
Harbaugh.
Who, yes. His theory is,
yes.
He's a football coach.
Yes.
He has a theory. His kids should wear two separate costumes. They go out, they get the candy in their neighborhood, they go home, they switch costumes, they go back to the same houses.
Right. Right.
It's like he strategizes and plots out Halloween
at $10 at Costco.
Yeah, but he wants...
And they get too much candy anyway.
Oh.
Do you think that that's sort of gaming the system and it's sort of a manipulation of the Hollywood spirit.
But I think good for him. Why not?
Jamie, that is totally unethical.
To go back and get candy from the same people?
You can't do a costume change and go back and get candy from the same people.
Beat the system.
That's other kids' candy.
Other kids will find
Jason's
their
instinct
candy.
On this is totally right.
What is the trick-or-treat cutoff? What is the age? Like, when do you, like...
Well, clearly, I'm not however old you are.
I need to know by tomorrow at 6.
We'll check with our sources and let you know.
So the book doesn't weigh in on the trick-or-treat cutoff age?
The book has no opinions about Halloween. That's for Little Victories, too. Yeah, that, we're going to get into all that.
We should say that the book is... People might think that it's gonna be sports related throughout, but it's really about, there's all different life events. You talk about your dad, you talk about your, I think it's your mom's aunt who lives in this beautiful, wonderful place.
Yeah.
And you talk about all these things that happen, like at an airport.
Oh, yeah. You say that you don't think that any of this, I'm yelling at the person in the line, is, none of that is effective.
Yeah. Well, I spend a lot of my life, because of my day job writing sports, in New York's cathedral, LaGuardia Airport.
Right. It is
and
a thing of beauty,
there
isn't
is nothing it? In the life of a New Yorker, and I know this is something you guys are interested in, there's nothing in the life of a New Yorker that will make you question your decision to move to New York. Like a solid 4 hours in LaGuardia Airport.
You don't even need that long.
And it is a laboratory of the most antisocial behavior you've ever seen in your life.
Oh, wait,
which
when,
is
when we did this trip to Florida on Sunday, it's 6 o'clock in the morning and already there's some guy yelling at the lady at the counter about something that she can't do anything about.
Right.
And I'm like, that's way too much anger for 6 a.m.
Absolutely. I was on a flight not that long ago where it was going to Tampa. And it was a JetBlue flight, so maybe this was JFK, in fact. But they were flying to, and they had made an announcement before boarding that the TVs didn't work. And you would have thought they said, "There's no right wing."
Because people then hit the outrage button.
People were like, one woman gets up there and goes, "What is the goddamn point of flying JetBlue?"
But what you say in the book is none of your rage is worth it.
Well, this is the thing about rage, but especially airport rage. It never works. It's O for rage. If we felt that rage like curling up in a fetal ball and saying that you thought you were going to get to Detroit by 2:30 and you missed your connection and screaming and knocking over stuff worked, do it.
Right.
But these people are trained, professionally trained,
to ignore
it entirely. And in fact, go out of their way to make you do nothing and go nowhere. So it's just, it's a reverse strategy. It accomplishes the exact opposite of what you're hoping to accomplish.
Jason, my wife's in the room. And Jamie's husband's in the room. I want to discuss one of the other points in your book, because you say, no gifts means no gifts.
Yeah.
We have a marital difference of opinion on
this. Oh, okay. Oh. So when you get an invitation
That says no gifts,
you're like, we got to stop somewhere and get something. Right? That's you?
No,
or your
sir.
Wife? She believes.
Sure, I said if it says no gifts, you're totally off the hook.
What's your price range on a no gifts gift? Can you shout it out? 40. 40?
Wow.
That's my gift range. That's my gift range.
You don't think you still have to do a bottle of wine, a flower, a something?
Listen, I don't want to really underline what a misanthrope I can be, but my favorite kind of party is the party I'm invited to and gets canceled at the last minute. Like, I've agreed to come, I'm going, they are excited that I'm coming, and then something comes up, hopefully non-emergency, it cancels. Mm-hmm. You get the goodwill of having RSVP'd and saying
yep.
you're going, and you can stay at home and Netflix. And I mean that in the stay at home and Netflix.
I was gonna say.
And not the meme stay at home and Netflix.
Netflix and chill.
No. Not that kind of show, Jamie.
Should we talk sports for 2 minutes, or is there anything?
Yeah. Yeah, I'm going to go right over to Citi Field and sit in the press box in this thing right after this. So I'm going to be, it's like me next to Roger Angel and...
But are you a Mets fan?
No.
As a national sports columnist, do you feel like you can freely express fandom?
Yes, I know, at the risk of alienating every last person here, you know, I grew up in a New England hamlet. I'll come right down and bite somebody.
I watched the Patriots game last night.
You did?
I kept thinking to myself, and this is off topic, but I kept thinking to myself as an Eagles fan, when the Eagles are watching the Pats play, like a game like last night, are they thinking, oh man, we gotta get our act together?
I think if an Eagles fan is watching a Patriots game, they're like, what is this sport? It's totally different. Like they throw the ball and somebody at the other end catches it. It's amazing. Is this Aussie rules?
Okay, do we have another guest coming out?
Oh no. Kansas City's up 1-0, bottom of the first. Yeah.
Downer.
Jason, you, as much as you find the quirks in New York City, you like it here.
I do. I mean, growing up in a New England hamlet, I feel New York City is a city where the common DNA strain is FOMO, fear of missing out. That everybody, especially anybody who moves here, has had fear of missing out their entire life. And if you live somewhere else, especially if you live in a quiet place, like the middle of the ocean, you want to... No, it's more like this.
Oh.
More like this.
I'm sorry. Shark expert.
You see New York City and you just think fun is being had that you are not part of. And moving here, the irony is you move here and then you don't do an effing thing. No, I did a lot, you know, but what I love about it, I love that even if I'm not having that wildlife that I may have had when I first moved to the city, people still have it. You know, the whole notion of like, oh, New York City ain't what it used to be. No one does this. No one. They're doing it. They're just doing it maybe in a different place and in a different way than you were doing it. And the reason I know this is that something I've adopted as I've become a geezer is riding my bicycle. And riding my bicycle very early in the morning.
Oh, well, that's a good time.
When you ride your bicycle early, and I'm talking like the sun is coming up on the Hudson.
You don't have to talk about it. You don't have to talk about early with us.
Oh, that's right. That's right. You guys are like, you're punching out.
Yeah.
Right, yeah. So you're riding your bike down the Hudson on like, and I like to go Saturday morning, and there's a whole group of New Yorkers still having Friday.
Oh yeah.
Like,
yeah.
Especially over where you are, you know?
So
like
when I pull up to Chelsea Market each morning, well, sometimes if I don't have a regular driver and I'm getting in a cab, they're like, oh, where? Dream Hotel?
Yeah.
And I'm like, yeah, Dream Hotel.
Exactly. Exactly. So you see people in clear club wear.
Yes.
In heels or whatever else. And it's obvious that, you know, couples have made decisions at 4:45 in the morning, let's walk over and to the West Side Highway and watch the sunrise.
Jesus.
And I just love that. I love seeing that, the beautiful
you
vomit on the
that.
West Side bike path.
Part of the fabric of the
I
city.
I mean, Sunday morning, okay, Halloween is on a Saturday night, okay? It's going to be really crazy, a Saturday night in New York, Halloween. The combination is just spectacularly toxic. You will... If you go about your traditional Sunday activities, especially early in the morning, you will see a man in a vomit-stained shark costume, not me, walking down Second Avenue. It's just a guarantee. But you'll also see that in February, and that's what I love about New York.
Round of applause for Jason Gay, everyone. There's the book, Little Victories, Perfect Rules for Imperfect Living.
Out Tuesday! Yeah. Out Tuesday.
Jason, will you stay with us and move to shark seat number two there?
Yes, sir.
You still want to keep the costume on?
Sure.
Okay, good, good. I don't want you to overheat up there.
And I feel like he's going to sweat and pass out.
I don't think it'll be a surprise to anybody to learn that of the two of us, Jamie has watched more of HBO's Girls than I have.
I love the show.
Does it speak to you?
It does speak to me.
Because, you know, it's set over in my part of the world in Brooklyn.
It is. It is set over in your part of the world. And what I love about it is that a lot of it feels really real to me because it's about girls who are around my age. Probably a little younger, actually. Please. But I love how they take on city politics and all of that sort of stuff also.
Our next guest, Alex Karpovsky, plays Ray Plushansky on Girls, a regular on the series since it launched in 2012. Alex joins us now. Welcome.
Hey. How's it going?
Alex.
Yeah, how's it going?
Hey.
How
are
you? Thank you. Good to have you.
It's my pleasure. Thank you very much. Hi.
I hope that the shark doesn't make you uncomfortable.
No, it smells nice too.
Oh, it does.
It smells like fresh pressed styrofoam.
Will you be dressing for Halloween tomorrow?
No, I'm not a Halloweener.
I would. And at what age did you move on from being a Halloweener?
Oh, I learned it from my father. We grew up, where are you from in Boston? Are you from Boston?
Yeah, I grew up in Belmont, Massachusetts.
Oh, I'm from Newton, Mass.
Oh, hi. Yeah.
Look at that. Yeah.
And when growing up in Newton, Mass, my dad would put up a sign. He hates life.
Oh.
And he put up a sign near our front door that said, no candy. And then one year, and a lot of people just didn't see it or didn't register it, so then the next year...
But he's not instead, like, giving out toothbrushes or something. It's strictly, like, don't come here.
Yeah, the door won't be answered.
Got it.
And then people didn't get the message, so the next year he put an exclamation point.
Oh. Did it work?
It did work.
Oh.
Was there any rage directed toward the household in the form of toilet paper being spread on the lawn or...
No, when you see a sign like that, you just keep walking, I think. I don't think you want to mess with that. And I, at the end of the day, I'm my father's son, so there's no... I love Halloween, I just won't be participating.
Well, so then maybe you are a lot like Ray in some ways, your character on Girls, because he ran for council member.
Yeah, what did he run?
Council board?
Council board. Yeah, head of the council board. That's it.
But it all stemmed from him hating the noisy traffic outside of his apartment.
Yeah.
So do you also hate noisy traffic outside of your apartment?
I hate unwarranted honking. It drives me crazy. I hate unwarranted idling. Bad for the environment, bad for me.
And yet you stay in New York.
I stay in New York. I have a very deep, complex love-hate relationship with New York.
I think a lot of people do.
I'm sure. I'm not.
The company sends a car for us at 4 a.m. to make sure we get to work safely. And sometimes they'll pull up in front of my place at 3:45 in the morning and honk. But honestly, at first, I'm going to be here. You know that I was expecting you. And my kids are sleeping right here right now.
Yeah.
Don't honk on the street, but yeah, there's a lot.
It was that same impulse that forced my character to sort of have some type of psychotic break. Go into the street, manifest his rage. I think there is a point to rage. I mean, I know you're an O for rage philosophy, and I understand that. But I feel like it's probably ineffective in the world, which is, I think, what you're saying. But in terms of getting it out, yeah, I think it's very, very healthy. Because if you keep that inside, you might very well blow a fuse.
So we met, first encountered Jason on Twitter and have a Twitter relationship. As I said, Jamie has tweeted 26,000 times. I've tweeted 24,000 times since the beginning of Twitter. Alex, you've tweeted 39 times.
I know, round of applause for that.
I've tweeted twice. I've retweeted 37 times.
Yeah. Did you use any social media, or are you just not?
Yeah, yeah. I'm on I like to watch. I like to kind of keep track of interesting people.
You're a lurker.
Well, lurker is a charged term. I like to appreciate and embrace the sensibility of people I respect. And Facebook allows me to do that. Twitter allows me, Instagram, a bunch of stuff.
I saw there was an interview you did a couple years ago. You said you actually turn off your internet when you write. So you prevent yourself from.
Oh, yeah. I'm way too twitchy. And like, I need to turn off.
Literally, you go 100% offline.
I do, yeah. I don't know how people don't. Like, if I just, if I'm writing anything that I hope is decent, I have to, like, get into a little bit of a rhythm and a groove, and I can't be distracted. Other people aren't that way, especially younger people.
Like the sharks that
aren't that way. The shark is doing fine. He can keep the Wi-Fi on. I just can't do it.
So Ray does he have any aspirations for higher office?
Yeah, I think there's a part of him that, once you start nibbling at a little bit of success in like local politics, I think like at night when you're wasted, you kind of start thinking, maybe I'll be president someday.
Like when you watch something like that debate this week, either thinking in Ray's head or as Alex, where would that go for you? Could you compete on the presidential stage?
Those guys they've been doing it for so long, and they have this sort of fleet of people that prepare them. So I don't think.
Well, you need practice first. So you know how there's people talk about de Blasio's New York, and they sort of use it as a snarky, like, there's a big line at the bagel store, de Blasio's New York. Like, what would Plushansky's New York look like, maybe if you were mayor?
Whoa. I don't know. I can tell you what Plushansky's America would look like.
Oh.
Oh, okay.
Why stop in New York? Well, I just feel like Plushansky.
Dream big.
Why stop in New York? I feel like Plushansky, to some degree, is a populist. I think he wants to. I think a lot of his sensibility would probably align with Bernie Sanders. Now that I think about it, he feels that there's a lot of things that the people want, but institutions, corporate media, billionaires on Wall Street, content, plump congressmen are not allowing to happen. And there's this roadblock between what the people want and there's a roadblock, you know what I'm saying. The people aren't getting what they want. And I think, I think if you took a, I have no backing for this, so I want to say that. But I think if you took a poll of America, like, should politicians hold stock? I think most Americans say, no, it's ridiculous. There's way too much special interest. Things are so corrupt in general. So that would be a rule in Plushansky's America.
It's okay.
Like, if you're in public office, you can't hold stock. You have to surrender it, and you can't hold stock for 3 years.
Because we pay them enough already that they shouldn't be allowed to hold stock.
Yeah, and it's going to completely skew and distort their interests. We do pay them plenty, and I think. And I think we should shrink the presidential election cycle.
Ugh.
You know, it's two years long, so it's literally half the time that you're in office. If you're a first
the Canadians were complaining theirs was like 11 days.
That's
or
perfect.
Something.
That's perfect.
Because less than 2 months.
Not only is it boring and it's just sort of feeding the coffers of corporate media, but also it's like the guys can't do their jobs. Like half the time that they get elected, they have to immediately go out with. And start campaigning. So we're electing to do something, but half the time they can't do it, and that's ridiculous. And every sort of Western country doesn't do what we do. I know we're a lot bigger, but still, it's ridiculous to have 2 years.
Ray Plushansky for president.
Yeah. Thank you. I'll be running in about 45 years.
Alex's favorite New York activity?
Favorite New York activity? Lurking. Yeah, followed by basketball. I like to lurk.
And you mentioned to me that your other favorite activity is happening on Sunday. The New York City Marathon.
Oh God, I hate the marathon. Sorry, I know I'm stepping on toes, but.
We actually, when we were considering this house that we bought on the marathon route, we actually thought that that was the greatest thing about it, was that we could have such a good marathon party if we buy this house.
Yeah.
You would not have been attracted to that.
It wouldn't have been a, you know, a tiebreaker.
A selling point.
Yeah, I don't think, no.
What's the problem with the marathon?
Yeah.
It's this nice event that all these people come in and they
we're celebrating health and we're celebrating New York and all. I don't get it, what's bad?
All the cups.
First of all, huge pollution problem.
Okay.
All these guys coming in, if it's boring, you want to watch people run, like go to Central Park, go to the West Side Highway. It's not that fun to see people run. They just run by. They're not going to do cartwheels. They're not going to do some crazy move.
Sometimes they wear like cool costumes and stuff.
Go to the internet. they mess up traffic patterns. I own a car. I live in Brooklyn. I use my car all the time. Sunday is the day to actually try to get a lot of chores done. Can't get anything done with the traffic patterns.
Amazon.com.
Yeah, I mean, go to Connecticut. Plenty of space. Run around, do your little dance, pollute that city.
It's one day out of the whole year.
Unnecessary.
It sort of goes along with how much you hate street fairs.
I know.
I feel like
the US Open and the marathon and game 3 of the World Series, those are iconic things that you can make exceptions for.
Right. And the Halloween parade too, we should.
Yes, that's true. Tomorrow night, New York One, me and Jamie hosting a Halloween parade. Alex, big February ahead for you. Girl Season 5, February 21st. Another Coen Brothers movie.
Mm-hmm.
You got an ongoing relationship with the Coen Brothers now?
I guess so. I've done two in a row. Yeah, I mean, they're like one of my favorite filmmakers, so to be invited back
like
after doing
too.
One, it's pretty neat.
Did they come to you initially after seeing something you did in Girls? Were you drawn to them?
I auditioned for a part in their new movie. It's called Hail Caesar, and it was unquestionably the worst audition of my life. It's the only time that, you know, you go in and you read a scene. It usually takes like 2 to 3 minutes to get through the scene. It's not that long. But it was the only time in my life where the casting director stopped me before I got to the end. She's like, that's okay. We don't need to keep going here.
But you thought it, I mean, part of you, like, she's stopping me because she's going to be like, oh my God, you're so great, you got it.
No. No,
we don't need to hear anymore.
I was sensing the vibe in the room. It was not working. I came in with a huge fake beard that I thought of the morning of the audition.
Aww.
So I like ran around to, I went to Abracadabra and got this beard. That's my way of negotiating with nervousness. Some people do other things.
Right.
Everyone's got their tactic. But anyway, so I didn't get a meaty role, but then they called me a few weeks later and said, look, that's not a good fit for you, but we'll give you this smaller role. Do you want it? And I said, of course.
Of course.
It's amazing, yeah.
Well, that's exciting. What can we look forward to from Season 5 on Girls?
Season 5, the girls are growing up. They're really entering deeper and deep. They're beyond the foothills of modern New York City womanhood. They're now kind of, you know, a good half the way up the mountain.
And like you've been with Shoshana, you've been with Marnie. Are you working your way through the group?
There is a new girl that I have a relationship. One of the girls.
Oh.
Yeah. That was exciting. I didn't know that until like a few days before I started shooting.
Wow.
Well, one thing that's really fun about the show is that it's very flexible and things change a lot, which I really like. It keeps things sort of vibrant and active. And they come up with new wacky ideas all the time, and then we're shooting them 3 days later. And, we get to improvise a lot. So there's a lot of flexibility from the actors and the writers, which makes it really fun.
A lurker on the internet, a man who won't be watching the marathon on Sunday, and man, who you can see in Season 5 of Girls starting February 21st. Alex, thank you.
My pleasure. Thank you very much.
Jason, thank you.
Thank you.
Round of applause for both of our guests, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you.
Thank you
very much. Thank you for
having me here. That was so
fun. Thank you
so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay.
Well.
Should we do the trivia thing?
We should.
Leslie?
And now, NYC Pop Trivia!
Okay, can we get a little bit of the house light up? Several times a year I do an event at the Bell House in Brooklyn where we do a pop culture trivia quiz, and I thought we would import a little bit of that with a New York theme.
Yeah.
So I need a couple of volunteers. If you think you have good New York City trivia knowledge, it'll be easy, I promise. I need two volunteers. There are prizes.
They're actually good prizes. Michael Scotto, I saw your hand.
New York One reporter Michael Scotto's hand went up. Who have we got over here? Who else is right back there?
Rob. I see Rob. Come on up, Rob.
Okay, we got you. Manhattan Borough President Gail Brewer is here. Gail, hang on. I'm gonna put you to work. All right, so. Here's how this works. I have a stack of questions in front of me. I have six of them. So we'll play the rules that we did on World Series of Pop Culture when I hosted that on VH1, where I ask a question of one person, and then if they don't get it, the other person gets to steal.
Has a chance to steal.
Yeah, and then the person who gets the most will win the grand prize. And we have a runner-up prize, too.
Yeah, and they're good prizes.
No, they are.
I was like, oh.
People here at 92Y were very generous with the prizes. Welcome.
Come Rob! On up here.
Good to meet you.
Thank you.
You're Rob?
I'm Rob.
That's Rob, and then I think Mike is coming.
I have no idea, I just got myself.
Oh, there he is.
Oh, we really are bringing Mike Scotto up?
Yeah, why not?
Okay, I feel like there's a conflict of interest there.
Is there?
Hi, Mike.
Nice to see you.
Well, good to have you here. We're putting you to work on some New York City trivia.
Michael Scotto is one of our colleagues at New York One.
The Manhattan Reporter now.
This is not rigged.
No, it's not rigged, but there was nobody else putting their hand up.
Nice.
Rob, you will be player number one. Mike, you'll be player number two. You ready for this? I have six questions. Rob, the first question goes to you. The most stolen sign in New York City is at the corner of Bowery and 2nd Street in Manhattan in honor of which legendary musician?
It's gotta be John Lennon.
Incorrect.
But great answer.
That was a good answer. Mike, can you steal?
Bowery and 2nd.
In honor of which legendary musician?
I don't know, is it a Ramon?
It is,
yes!
Joey Ramone. Joey Ramone. Mike's up 1-0.
Impressed. Are you keeping score?
I am keeping score.
Okay.
I mentioned that we saw Gail Brewer in the audience. Gail? If I give you a microphone?
There we go.
Can you come up with a Manhattan trivia question? Manhattan Borough President Gail Brewer, ladies and gentlemen.
I think Simon and Garfunkel played in Central Park. And what person had more of an audience than Simon and Garfunkel?
Oh, good question. Mike, this is your question. It was a 1997 concert.
Country music star.
Who exceeded Simon and Garfunkel for a Central Park concert attendance record?
What's his name? God.
I have an answer here.
Garth.
Don't give the answer yet, Gail.
That was.
I don't think we heard it up here.
I heard it, but.
Oh.
You take it.
I think I heard, and I was going to guess, of course, Garth Brooks.
That is correct.
Mike, you didn't have the. We're giving the point to Rob there. All right,
I actually did know that.
Gail, thank you. Thank you for being here, Gail.
Thank you, Gail.
Glad to be in your borough for the event tonight. All right, Rob, here's question three. What salad made up of apple, celery, walnuts, and mayonnaise is named after the iconic New York City location where it was created?
That's to me.
No, this is Rob's question.
I think it's.
Sure, it is a salad made up of apples, celery, walnuts, and mayonnaise.
Oh, the audience knows.
Named after the iconic New York City location where it was created.
I'll give you another clue.
No, don't give it away. Mike can steal.
Everybody knows.
All right, Rob, time's up.
I'm from New Jersey.
Time's up. Mike, for the steal?
The Waldorf Astoria.
That is the Waldorf salad, yes. Mike's up 2-1. Mike, this is your question.
These are hard.
They're not that hard. What is the name of the McDonald's knockoff on Queens Boulevard in the movie Coming to America?
Oh. McDowell's?
McDowell's,
yes,
is correct. All right, Rob, Mike is up 3-1, which means that Eve, to tie, you would have to get these two questions correct. So you're on the ropes here. Prior to our current mayor, Bill de Blasio, of course, so who was the last New York City mayor to actually live in Gracie Mansion?
Well, it's not Bloomberg, we know that. Giuliani?
Giuliani's,
yes,
correct. Rob stays in the competition, but this last question is directed to Mike. Mike, you can wrap it up with a correct answer. What New York City baked good causes Jerry to abruptly end his non-vomit streak in a classic episode of Seinfeld?
Oh, I don't know.
Jerry ended a non-vomit streak by consuming this New York City baked good.
He's like, text me the answer.
New York City baked good. Like, you only, like a black and white cookie?
Yes!
Mike wins 4-2. Mike, you know what?
I'm gonna give the gift.
Yeah, that's what I was gonna say. I'm giving you the runner-up prize.
That's fine.
And I'm giving Rob the grand prize because there's no conflict of interest there. Mike Scotto is gonna come back to 92Y for a show of his choosing. Perhaps John Leguizamo on November 13th. Perhaps Louis Black on November 10th or something else. Mike, thank you for coming. Rob, this is a nice prize from the May Fitness Center, a 3-month membership, a $500 value here at 92Y. Congratulations to both of our players.
Thanks, thank you for playing.
Thank you.
Thanks for coming up.
Thanks.
Okay, this is the part of the show where we were supposed to, first of all, update the baseball score. What is it? 3-2 Royals?
Oh.
And what inning is it? All right, our final segment is your questions. What? Okay, so audience questions before we wrap up. Jamie, would you like to read this question?
Jamie, this is so rude. Why do you say Van Wyck instead of Van Wyck?
Who comes into our house and corrects our pronunciation? Oh, wait a minute, you were correcting my pronunciation a minute ago.
Because there is a right way and a wrong way to say it. If I said your name was Pat Kiernan, or Pat, I don't even know how else to say your name. Mm-hmm. Okay.
So settle Van Wyck, Van Wyck.
I'm going to settle it once and for all. I understand that all New Yorkers like to say it the wrong way, but Van Wyck... Van Wyck, excuse me, Van Wyck. Van Wyck is the actual way that the Dutch family said their own name. It's named for a Dutch family, Van Wyck. And so that is how we say it because we like to honor them and all their traffic in the right way.
Okay.
I get that all the time.
Yoshi says, I love Canada, I'm a big fan. What time do you go to bed and what time do you wake up and are you sleepy now? Show's been that good, huh?
A?
I said hey, not A.
I thought you said A. Oh.
I sleep 2 hours in the afternoon and 4 hours at night. So I do like noon to 2 and then 11 to 3.
Which is insane.
So otherwise you miss all the life. What do you do?
What have I missed? Nothing. Let me tell you something.
Okay.
I go to bed at, it depends on the night, but like 6, 7, 8. Depends what's going on. I know, oh, she's missing the party. Last night, because I had off this morning, my husband Brian comes home from work It's about 9 o'clock at night. We ordered in sushi. We're watching football. We're staring at each other and we're like, this is it? This is what people stay up for? And it's like, no, not worth it. Going, sleep is worth it.
You got another one there?
With all of these busy New Yorkers, slow tourists, and millions of people in this amazing city, what is your craziest, bizarre fan encounter? Leslie. I love you, Leslie.
I thought you meant me. I was like, I'm sitting right here. I can hear you. Literally sitting here.
You didn't write that question?
Maybe.
Craziest, bizarre fan encounter?
I don't know if I have a crazy one. It's more just when people see me, they only see me on TV and they're really taken aback by how short I am. They always are like, oh my God, you're so tiny. And I'm like, well, it's better than being like, oh my God, you're huge.
No, because I get all the time, you're taller, so like, you're taller in person. It's like, how would you know?
I know. How Everyone's always like, you look so tall on TV. I'm like, what do you mean? I look so tall.
What's your point
on
of reference?
TV.
You're not standing next to anyone. I'm sitting all the time.
Right. That, I don't get it.
Jamie, I think this is one that we can go out on a good note.
Okay.
If you could live anywhere, where would you choose?
I mean, I'm supposed to say New York, right?
But you don't want to say New York?
I mean, I love New York. My dream is to live on a farm somewhere.
No.
I love animals, and I love animals. I love the open earth, but I mean, I'm sticking in New York.
I'm good with New York now, too.
Yeah.
Good. We'll be here with you for a while.
So tomorrow, we have the Halloween parade.
7:30 telecast.
On New York One, we'll be there for 2 hours, and...
The costumes are good this year.
They actually really are.
Every year we team up with a Broadway show to dress us. And the new School of Rock musical is dressing us this year.
We have wigs, we have accessories.
I got sleeves of tattoos.
Yeah, we got a lot going on. So, I guess I'll sit with you again for another few hours tomorrow night.
You got the Halloween candy already, thanks to the shark.
So hopefully you will watch us there on New York One tomorrow night, or any morning, of course. And otherwise, we'll be back here on Thursday, November 19th.
Yes, so if you enjoyed it tonight, come back Thursday, November 19th. Tell your friends that you enjoyed it. If you didn't, just leave quietly. Good to be here with you. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you.
That was Pat and Jamie's New York. That was Pat and Jamie's New York. That-